the way up to my hips, and I'm waiting. And I'm wading through, trying to find my friend's voice. I could hear it as about like 100 meters away. I'm looking up at this big fence, and it looks very intimidating. But I hear my voice, Adam! My friend's voice. And eventually, as I'm walking through, I'm feeling all those kind of itchy little bits of the grass get into my, I'm wearing shorts stupidly that day. And yeah, it's kind of getting in my shirt a little bit. And then finally I see over here a path. And you know, when I actually see what you would see when you expect to go on a hike, and it's leading up towards the fence in front of me. And then in front of me, I see Peter. Peter is the friend who taught me that nowhere is impossible to get to if you have a bicycle. He's the friend that taught me anywhere is a bed. And I'm sitting here as he's at this chain link fence, pulling it up. Come on in, Adam. I take a big deep breath, feel a little nervous, but as I often do with this friend, I decide to follow him into the dark. It's 2015. I'm in Japan for the first time in my life. I've been living in Taipei, which is a separate country, for about 7 years. I'd actually gotten a little bit tired of my life there. I had been someone who, before my time in Taipei, had been moving around all the time. People would say, what's Adam up to next? Always taking all these new opportunities and building his career. And now I found myself in a state where I had a failed relationship and a failed business. I really didn't know what I was gonna do next. I was working a job, teaching English, something I really swore I'd never really do. And then I decided it was time for a change. And so I decided I was gonna drop everything and move to Australia. And so this trip to Japan with my friend Peter really felt like an opportunity for me to kind of get a bit of that old Adam back, that sort of jumping into the wind and see where it goes. It had been a rough couple first days. We arrived, it had been a huge storm. We had to sleep overnight in the airport because the transit was closed. And then once we head out, as per often our typical fashion, we didn't really reserve anything anywhere, which can often lead to very unexpected and wonderful interactions with people. It could also lead to a big, dark, empty path where you realize you just have to lie down. And so we had a couple nights where, not really fully prepared, we were just lying on the floor, kind of shivering in our sleep, in like a half hour of quality sleep. We end up in the city of Nara, which is the original capital of Japan. And finally, after one of those groggy cold mornings, we decide, okay, we're gonna go to the closest town and we're finding a friggin' hostel. So we walk along and then we finally get into a town. We see the 7-Eleven. We see just nice morning restaurants, people going about their day, and it's kind of that ease back into, okay, this is a kind of a regular city life. We go to a hostel and it's early morning, about 6 a.m. We say, can we just sleep here? And luckily they had a space for us. So we go into this hostel. It's a cheap, crappy bed. It's not the most beautiful place, but that just felt like the most luxurious king-size experience of my life. And I just knocked out for about 16 hours. The next day, Peter and I, we wake up and we talk to the host, and he says, welcome to Nara. Well, how can I help you? What do you, you know, any advice you want to know? And we're like, well, what's something interesting to do here? We didn't really do any research. We want to check out what's going on. And he said, I have something really cool you need to check out. Have you heard of Nara Dreamland before? I was like, no. I was like, well, do you like going on roller coaster rides? I was like, yeah. And he's like, well, too bad, because this is an amusement park, but you can't go on the rides. Why not? And he said, well, it's been closed for 20 years. Cool. Okay. So, you know, Pete and I, we just look at each other. How do we get there? You know, we're going to go for, actually, we can walk there. It's about an hour walk. So we didn't really have much of a plan. We start, you know, exiting the city. We're walking out. We're just on our path. Eventually, the city disappears behind us, and we're just walking along dirt road, hoping that we know where we're going to end up. It seemed like pretty clear directions. And that's when we find the outer gate of the place, and we're really trying to find a way in. And that's when I hear, Adam! Adam, I found the place! I found the way in! And we go inside. And it was not disappointing at all. The first thing that we see is a big, just a regular big roller coaster, one of those big wooden ones. It has all the loops. It has that, you know, the place you line up for an hour, and then I walk up, and it's all wooden. But the difference is that it's completely covered in shrubbery, and everything is ripped and decayed. And instead of sitting there and waiting to go into your little thing and go on the ride, there's no one there, so you just walk onto the tracks. So we just start walking onto these tracks, covered in leaves, and it's just remarkable. I've never seen a full roller coaster loop that's just completely drawn with vines and leaves. It's just stunning. So we come down from that roller coaster, and then we start to walk around. Now, Pete and I, we have a tradition when we go traveling. And when we enter a new city or a new place, the first thing we try to do after like resting or settling down is find the highest point of that place, just so we can kind of see where we are, just catch our bearings, get to just breathe in the place we're in. And just so happened that this place had a highest peak, and it was actually on a mountain. But it was a mountain that was similar to a mountain in Canada's Wonderland, in so far as it's not a natural mountain. It's a roller coaster mountain. So we decide to walk over to this fake mountain where we realize the side is made out of fake rock. We find little cracks inside that we go inside, and then we realize, I don't know if you've ever, it felt like I was like pulling up the curtain of a mountain and just saw like blank empty space. It was quite surreal. So we realized there wasn't much to see inside, but we wanted to get to the top. So we would find, we were crawling along until we found a way to get up. And fortunately, this is a man-made mountain, so staff have to find ways to crawl up and fix all the different things on the tracks. This one, it had a ladder, which was not a ladder, it's just pieces of metal that are bent out to form handles all in a row, so you're just climbing up these metal bent wires until you get a little higher. So we got about halfway up until we can stop and we can kind of breathe a little bit. We see the track of the roller coaster along the side, and we decide, okay, this is interesting. Should we go higher? Okay. So we kept walking around, and then we find another ladder. We go up a little higher and higher and higher until we're about, I'd say, about 10 to 12 stories above ground. And it's at this point, it feels a little vulnerable because you're on these rickety kind of metal ladders, but there's nothing, it's just a mountain on the side, and it just goes straight down to a drop. I'm getting quite nervous, but my friend Peter, he's not daunted at all. We keep climbing up another 4-5 flights until eventually we get to the top. And this top, the wind is really blowing. And I'm just kind of standing there, ready to go into the last ring, and he's up there saying, Adam, we're at the top, it's the most beautiful, this is amazing, come up here, we'll take some pictures together. And there's something in me, it's like, man, I can't. Yeah, I can't, I'm sorry, like, it's just, this last bit, I'm just gonna sit here. So I just stand there, I watch him kind of take some awesome selfies. He takes pictures of me kind of like holding on the ladder for my dear life, just not able to go up any higher. And then we just make our descent. And then after that, we kind of start being really just obnoxious kids in a candy store, because we really love to, I feel like in a post-apocalyptic situation, we would be the people that find all the like hidden medicine randomly in houses and stuff like that. We just love finding like little things everywhere. And so this is, you know, this is our candy store. And as we're walking by, we see like a kind of a van just drives along the side of us. And it seemed very casual. We're like, okay. So then we decide to go up and to look at the children's area. And then there's a big witch. Her face is basically half the size of the stage. And I decide to crawl up on the side and you know, lean on the witch's face and just have a good time. We come down and we go into the castle area, and there's a big, there's a giant stone statue of a horse, and so I jump on the horse, and we're like, woo, having a good time. We're really being quite this obnoxious and having a good time together. And then finally, we go, and then we find just the jackpot for us, which is the arcade area. We walk into the arcade area, and just machines upside down, just prizes, things smashed open all over the place. I grab a little doll thing to put in my pocket for later. I grab a little, you know, coin prize thing, put it in the pocket. It all feels like treasure to me. It feels like we're treasure hunting. And I'm feeling really exhilarated, you know. For someone like me, I'm never someone who ever skipped a class, but I did have like a pink mohawk. So I didn't really like to upset or break rules, but I did, you know, like to kind of push the boundary a little bit. Just in, as long as I'm not hurting anyone, I'm not, you know, causing any problems. And so this was kind of like a midway, you know, like I'm not harming anyone walking around in this abandoned place. It's actually quite cool, but we are breaking some rules, but it's the kind of rule I don't feel that bad. I don't feel that bad. But, you know, when I do break rules, I get kind of panicky. I don't know if people, you know, when you have an issue with authority, so when you're, you know, upsetting somebody, it's like, oh no, it's all over, I'm going to jail now. You know, like that sort of, I can really quickly fall into that mode. So we're walking through this area, and then we hear a little crack outside, and we're like, oh, maybe there's someone else here. But then, you know, it goes away. So then we kind of go a little further in, and then we open the door, and we end up in the administrative offices, which was really cool to me. Doesn't sound exciting, but just seeing post-apocalyptic offices through the drawers, you know, like old pictures, it had a really cool feeling to it. And then, you know, as we're walking through here, all of a sudden, as we're crunching through the floor, which is just covered in broken glass, we hear other crunching on the outside. And we're like, oh, is, you know, we're like cats when a cat hears like something that you can't hear. And, oh, so we were like a little bit on edge. And then we keep going, and then until we kind of slowly realize as we're parsing through and picking things up that, no, that's not just us crouching. There's like this crackling sound happening outside too. And we stop, it stops. And then we go again. And then all of a sudden we hear the outside kind of crackling sounds. And then Peter and I are looking at each other. And then it just kind of starts raising into this sort of like tension of like, is there someone out there? What's going on? And all of a sudden we hear a bunch of voices being like, hey, what? And then we look at each other and I just look at him and I say, run! And then we just jump out the window and dart as fast as we can. And to our, not to our surprise, there's a van with people yelling at it, get down, get down! And then we keep running and running until we're all the way halfway through the park. But then we can't outrun a van. So the van runs out and runs in front of us, cuts us off. And then it basically, two guys walk out and they yell, get on the floor, get on the floor! And we're like, ah, get on the floor. Put your hand behind your head! Okay. I'm sorry. And Peter freaks out, and he's like, oh, I'm so sorry, please don't. We're so sorry, we're just gonna leave. And then these guys, they come out, and it's all just a flash. I don't know what's happening. I just feel like, oh my God, I'm going to jail. This is the end. What did I think I was doing? My whole body is just like freezing. And then all the while, they're just yelling at us and swearing. Get on the floor, you fucking ass, fucking foreigners. What do you think you're doing? Just yelling in this very rough Japanese accent, but they've clearly done this before. They get us to take out our phones, and then they make us open it for them and just take every picture we've taken and just delete it. And then they throw our phones on the side. And then they're just kind of like, we're gonna call the police, just you wait here, you're gonna go to jail. And then Peter's just freaking out and just saying, I'm really sorry. And then I'm kind of looking at the situation, and my head just starts to defog for a second as I'm kind of lying on the floor and just like looking at the side. And I'm like, oh, okay, Peter, I don't want to start kind of begging for leaving, because I can tell it's kind of making them a little more aggressive. But then I kind of look up at them, and I'm kind of thinking a bit more clearly, and they're not really wearing uniforms or anything. They're kind of just in cargo pants and shirts. And I'm like, these guys are being really freaking aggressive. Like, where's this coming from? And then so I kind of just on the floor, I'm like, hey, what's your name? And they're like, what? I'm like, sorry. And then I just kind of get up onto my knees, and I just say, do you have like, what's your card? Can I have your card? I have a lawyer back in Nara, my uncle, and we're going to jail, so I need to call my lawyer to figure out how we're gonna do this. Can I have your name and your card? And then they just kind of stand next to each other, and then start whispering to each other a little bit. And then one of the guys just goes out and walks to his car. And then he pulls out his card, and you know, in Japan, he hands it with two hands. Okay, thank you. Okay, so can I go get my phone? I need to call the lawyer now so we can, you know, figure out how we're gonna go to the police station. And then they kind of just look at each other, talk a little bit more. Look at Pete, and he's like, what the fuck are you doing, man? And then I just kind of, you know, put it in my pocket. They say, okay, get in the truck. So they have this truck, and it's one of those pickup trucks with the open back. We both sit in the back together, and then we're just looking at each other, just, are we going to the police now? Like, what are we gonna do? And then obviously, are they gonna call my bluff because I have no freaking lawyer here? They drive us all the way through a route we didn't really know before, and then over through a gate, and then back to where we entered from. I think they knew where we came in from. And then they say, get the fuck out of here. So him and I just, we just inch ourselves off of the truck, and then we start walking. And I don't know if you know how vulnerable it feels to just be slowly walking away from people and you don't know what they're going to do. So we just start walking slowly and just praying, are we okay? Is this actually done? And then we just keep walking. And then slowly, as we reach about 10 minutes of walking, there's been no one yelling after us, no cars going after us. We start to ease a little bit, and then we keep walking. And eventually, we're just walking normally. We enter into the Nara city, and then we see the 7-Eleven, and we see the place. And then we're just there walking side by side. And then finally, for the first time in over maybe 40 minutes, we just look at each other, and then we just start laughing. Thank you.